So hi guys, my name is Mansi Anand and I welcome you to this series called RBI 24/7. So as most of you would be knowing that in this series we discuss 5 questions about finance and economics current affairs which can be of use to you if you are preparing for competitive exams, right? So before moving to question number 1, I would like to ask you guys to subscribe to our channel. So if you are a new entrant here and watching our video for the first time, then don't forget to press this button here. It can help you to stay in touch with us, and you can also press this bell icon. It will help you to get all the notifications whenever a new video comes up, right? And after that, you can also join our Telegram group. On this group, you can post all your doubts and queries and we'll try to resolve them as soon as possible. So are you ready for question number 1? And let's see what the question number 1 is. So here is your question number 1. I hope the screen is perfectly visible. Let's see what the question says. So this question says, out of the following statements about RBI's new card guidelines, select the incorrect statement. So guys, do keep a note here that you have to select the incorrect statement, not the correct ones, right? So 3 statements given to you. Here you can pause the video and read these statements carefully and then decide your answer. Moving ahead to the solution for this question. And the solution for this question is option A. So option A means 1, 2 and 3. So it means all the statements which are mentioned here, they are incorrect. They are the wrong statements, right? So RBI has come up with some new guidelines which is going to tell banks that how they have to manage the debit cards and credit cards that they issue and their transactions, right? So let us learn about these new guidelines. So first, at the time of issue and reissue of shares, at the time of issue and reissue of cards, all debit cards and credit cards shall be enabled for use at ATMs and POS machines. So first of all, guys, obviously we use these cards, these credit cards and debit cards, and whenever you need money, you need in hard cash, what do? You withdraw your money from the ATM. Or let's say you are at a shop and you need to make a payment, then how are you going to make a payment? One method is to use a point of sales machine. So it is a black colored machine in which you swipe your card and then enter your PIN and then you can make your payment, right? So this statement is saying, RBI has told the banks that whenever you issue these cards should be issued for use at ATM machines and POS machines, not across the world, but within India, right? So let's say you are shopping somewhere in India and you want to make a payment at a POS machine, or you want to withdraw money from an ATM machine which is located in India, then you can do it. But let's say you go to some other country, let's say you have been on USA for a vacation, and then if you want to withdraw money from your ATM card, then you cannot do it. So banks by default will not enable their cards for international ATMs and POS transactions, only domestic transactions. But let's say if you are going to any other country, if you are going to US for vacation or some work, and obviously then you will need money, right? You will need to withdraw money from ATM, or you will need to make a payment, then how are you going to do it? So beforehand, you will have to take approval of your bank, the credit card or the debit card that you are holding, the issuer bank. So if you have a SBI card, you will have to take a permission from that bank. After that, your card will be enabled for the international transaction. So that is why this statement is also wrong. So if the customers want to use their cards outside India, they will have to take permission from the concerned bank, right? After that, the second statement says, RBI has determined spending and transaction limit which has to be followed by every debit or credit card holder. So this statement is not right. That is because RBI has not determined this limit, but RBI is saying banks to give power to these credit card and debit card holders so that they can set their own spending and transaction limit. So let's say if I'm having a card, I can set the limit that I can transfer money to a limit of rupees 1 lakh in a day, not more than that. So if anybody would try to make transfer money from my account, which is in excess of this limit, then they will not be able to do so, right? So this is one limit, this is one one guideline that customers themselves would be able to set their own limits, right? So we have corrected these three incorrect statements. Moving ahead to some more guidelines. Here you can see, so for existing debit card holders, issuers may take a decision based on risk perception whether to disable card not present transactions, card present transactions and contactless transactions, right? So guys, do understand this point. Do pay a little attention here. So first of all, we are talking that, let's say if I have a card, from SBI Bank, right? Now, if I want to make a payment, see, by default, this card would allow me to make card present payment, which is domestic in nature. So we just learned about that it would be available for use within India at all the ATM machines and POS machines, right? So if I am getting into a transaction in which my card is present, just like withdrawing money from ATM or making payment through a POS machine, so you need a card physically for that. So that is a card present transaction. So card present domestic transactions are available, but granting international rights is within the purview of the bank. So if SBI wants, it can grant me the right, or if it doesn't want, it can deny me the right to use my card to indulge into a card present transaction at an international level, right? Basically, there are some criteria by which banks have to look that whether they should grant these rights to the customer or not, right? After that, for card not present transactions. So if, let's say I'm shopping at Myntra and I want to order a dress. Now that dress, I want to make payment for that and I'm making that payment through my card. But I don't physically need the card, provided if I have the details which are mentioned on the cards, right? So I don't physically need the card. So that is an example of card not present transaction, although you are using the details which are mentioned at the card. So if it is within the purview of issuing bank that whether to grant the right for this transaction, this card not present transaction, or not at both domestic and international level, right? After that, if there is any contactless transactions using some NFC technology, so we have discussed about NFC technology, near field communication, right? So guys, if you are not familiar with this NFC transaction term, you can ask for its link in the comments. We have discussed this in detail in one session, right? So I hope now you get it. So basically, giving banks the right that you decide whether to give customer these rights or not, right? So after that, all banks, card issuing companies have been asked by RBI to disable online payment for all debit cards that have never been used for online or contactless transactions in India or abroad. So simple, if there is a card which has not been used for a very long time or has not been ever used for an online transaction, so no online transaction ever done from a particular card, or no contactless transaction ever done from that card, then the banks or the issuing company would have to disable those cards. After that, people will now be able to register for preferences. So giving more power to the card holder that they can decide the services that they want for their card, or if they do not want certain services, they can restrict the use of those services, like setting the spending limits, as I just told you, and other services for online transactions, international transactions, or contactless transactions. So guys, why are these steps being taken? So this is to prevent the misuse of cards or prevent the misuse of online transfer of money, right? So if you have set a limit of rupees 1 lakh, as I just told you in the example, then if any transaction is happening from your card which is higher than that, your bank is going to stop it, right, and intimate you about it. So basically, your money, to make your money more safer, so that those services or those transactions which you are not giving the right to or which you are not opting for, they should not happen through your card. Because recently there have been many complaints of online thefts, online frauds, right? So to prevent all this, apart from that, RBI has been running campaign, RBI says or RBI kehta hai, right? And we recently discussed which actor has been roped in, Amitabh Bachchan, as you guys rightly mentioned in the comments. After that, users will have a 24/7 access to switch on or off or change transaction limits. So basically more power to users. After that, cardholders on both debit and credit will have a new facility to set up transaction limit, how much is the limit that they want for their transactions, right? These directions are issued under section 10, subsection 2 of PSS Act, right? Moving ahead to question number 2, and here is your question number 2 for today. Okay, right? So I hope the screen is perfectly visible. This question number 2, it says rating agency CRISIL, it defines its credit ratio as the ratio of upgrades to downgrades. So what do you think is the relationship between an industry's financial vulnerability and its credit ratio? Right, you have to tell the relationship. So I hope the options are perfectly visible and you can pause the video and think about the solution. Moving ahead to the correct option for this question, and the correct option for this question is option E. So option E means, here you can see there is a negative relationship between industry's vulnerability and its credit ratio for all the values of credit ratio. So guys, this question is very simple. It might seem like really complex and big, but it is very simple, and let us discuss it. So here we are talking about credit ratio that credit rating agency CRISIL is holding. So you have to just apply basic maths here. So this credit ratio, this is being defined as number of upgrades divided by number of downgrades. So let's talk about an industry. If we talk about banking sector, so how many banks have seen upgradations in their credit rating position, and how many banks have seen a downgrade in their credit worthiness? So when you divide these two, then you are going to get the credit ratio for a particular industry. So this can be calculated for industry as a whole or for separate industries like banking, pharmaceuticals, automobiles, right? So a very simple ratio. So the high, see, since number of upgrades is at the top, is a numerator, that means the higher the ratio, the more the number of upgrades, the higher is the credit ratio, right? So higher credit ratio means that an industry is doing good. That means more firms in that particular industry, they are getting upgraded rather than downgraded, right? That is why if any industry has a high positive ratio for that, so if any industry has a high credit ratio, that means its vulnerability is less. That gives us a negative relationship between credit ratio and an industry's vulnerability, right? So that is why this option is correct. So that means the credit ratio cannot turn negative, right? So that means for all values of credit ratio, there is going to be a negative relationship. The higher the credit ratio, the less is industry's vulnerability. Here you can see certain statistics. For Indian companies, the ratio was mentioned at 0.54. So 0.54, which is not a very high credit ratio, that means higher vulnerability. So low credit ratio, higher vulnerability, lowest in more than a decade, which poses our companies, our industries as vulnerable financially. So while the rate of upgrades plunged, so they are saying that there are lesser companies which saw upgradations as expected because of pandemic. It was expected that that lesser companies would see an increase in their credit worthiness. The rate of downgrades did not surge. So they are saying that the companies that saw a fall in their credit worthiness that did not raise, or the number of downgrades that did not rise, that is because of regulatory measures which were taken by central bank, as they say, they told banks or the lenders that you do not have to downgrade the asset. That is why the number of downgrades, they did not rise much. So since downgrades did not rise much, obviously it was expected that upgrades are not going to rise much. So it provided cushion, the regulatory measures. So high resilience sectors such as pharma had a credit ratio of over 1 in the first half of the fiscal, led by a steady demand, robust balance sheets. Some sectors like pharma performed well. Moving ahead to the next question for today, here is your third question. And this third question says, select the correct statement about the interest rates on small savings scheme and banks fixed deposit. So five statements given to you, you have to select the correct one. Moving ahead to the solution for this question, and the solution says C is the correct answer. Okay, widening gap between interest rates offered by small savings schemes and fixed deposits with the latter less than the former. That means the interest rate on FDs is less than the interest rate on the small saving schemes. So when this is happening, when the interest rate which is provided by banks on fixed deposit, it is less than the reward or interest on small saving schemes, in that case the savers are expected to go towards the small saving scheme. So guys, very simple, since the interest rate is high on small saving scheme, the savers are getting more benefit, more interest rate, that is why they are going to move to small savings scheme, right? So in this question, you just have to figure out this part with the latter less than the former. So you have to read this part carefully and the last part carefully, right? Very simple question. Moving ahead, here you can look at the solution, right? Finance ministry's move to keep small savings rate unchanged. So finance ministry did not change any rates provided on small savings schemes, and we have discussed that banks are not able to provide high deposit rates considering the situation currently of pandemic. That is why banks have slashed the deposit rates, but that which has made the small saving schemes more attractive than putting your money into FD with a bank, right? So if your bank FDs are close to maturities, you can gain higher returns by making new FDs at post office. If you want to put your money in small saving schemes, that is going to provide you with higher benefit. So these are guaranteed by the government, and the tax treatment is also same as the bank FDs, right? So these are some advantages of putting money with the post office or putting money in a small saving scheme, for depositing your money with the post office. However, there is one point, you may not get the same level of convenience such as net banking and bill payment services for post office accounts, since we get these facilities with the banks. So premature termination, if you want to withdraw your money before the tenure of the deposit ends, that is also a bit more complex and difficult with the post office accounts as compared to a FD at bank, right? Moving ahead to the next question for today. And here is your fourth question for today. And this question talks about Gandhian economics. So you have to select the statement, or you have to select the characteristics which tells you some traits about the Gandhian economics. Let's see what the correct option is. The correct option for this question is option B. Option B means only three. Right? So only three. Rejection of concept of human beings as a rational actor. So whenever we talk about any theory in economics or we talk about any concept, most of the times the basic underlying assumption is that the consumer is a rational consumer who is going to think about self-interest, basically maximization of satisfaction or maximization of self-interest, right? But Gandhian economics is a different concept. So recently we had Gandhi Jayanti, right? Last week. So I thought let us discuss something about Gandhian economics. So this is very well opposed to the concepts which are popular in the Western economics. As you can see here, School of Economic Thought based on socio-economic principles expounded by Gandhi, largely characterized by rejection. So basically, what this concept entails is that humans should not focus on maximization of self-interest. Rather, they should not be greedy in consuming the resources. There should not be materialism, right? Or we should not focus on individualism. We should not think about ourselves as an individual, but we should think about what is going to benefit all the human beings as a community rather than an individual, right? So always seek, so the concept of rational actor, always seeking to maximize material self-interest, that underlies classic economic thinking, where Western economics focuses on multiplication of wants. That means more and more things that a consumer wants, right? So we also have theories where we say that a consumer goes for that set of goods where there are more of either of at least one of the good, if we talk about two goods, right? So Gandhi calls this multiplication of wants, that we should focus on what we need rather than what we want. Felt that this was both unsustainable because earth won't be able to provide resources for the wants of so many people, and devastating to the human spirit. So as a school of economics, resulting model contained elements of nationalism. So the model of economics under the principles of Gandhi, it contains some elements of nationalism, basically having love for your own country, adherence to non-violence. So see, the time when Gandhi was born, that was a war-ridden time, right? So that time it was very difficult to think for a country to prosper without indulging into war with any other country, to gain control of the resources of that particular country, or to gain control of territory of that particular country, right? So it was difficult to think of non-violent economics at that time. And a rejection of class war in favor of socio-economic harmony. So economic ideas aim to promote spiritual development and harmony with the rejection of materialism. There should not be focus on materialism. Whereas when we talk about the Western economics, we always say demand. Demand is very important. We have to generate demand, right? So this demand, it comes from the concept of materialism, that people should focus on materials, or they should want different things in their life, then only there is going to be demand for so many products and services. The term Gandhian economics coined by J.C. Kumarappa, close supporter of Gandhi, right? Moving ahead to last question for today. Here is the last question, which says, in an affidavit submitted to Supreme Court on 3rd October, central government said that it would get interest on interest liability waived on borrowings of up to rupees dash. Very simple question. Let's see what the correct answer is. The correct option is option D, that is rupees 2 crores. So guys, we have discussed this concept so many times, that how banks and RBI, they did want to waive this interest on interest. See, RBI has provided the extension, or government has provided the moratorium, that for a particular period of time borrowers आर अलाउड नॉट टू पे विदाउट अ डाउनग्रेड इन देयर एसेट इन देयर क्रेडिट वर्थीनेस और इन देयर क्रेडिट स्कोर. बट द पॉइंट इज सी बैंक्स दे व्हेनेवर यू पे एन ईएमआई टू अ बैंक बैंक रिसीव द प्रिंसिपल अमाउंट. अपार्ट फ्रॉम दैट दे रिसीव द इंटरेस्ट दैट वी आर पेइंग ऑन द लोन. Right, so these are the components of EMI that you pay monthly whenever you have taken a loan from the bank. So see, if a borrower is not paying an EMI or having an extension, then bank is not getting the principal as well as they are not getting the interest. So they are saying that interest should be charged on this interest also because there is a delay in banks receiving that interest, right? So there was this debate has been going on for a long time because RBI and banks, they didn't want to waive it off because obviously it is a source of revenue for them. Why would they want to waive it off? But Supreme Court was saying that no, this is too much burden on borrowers. Now government is saying that till the loans of 2 crores or borrowings up to 2 crores, we are going to waive this interest and interest, but we are not going to make any losses to the bank because government is going to take that financial burden or compensate banks for that loss, right? Here you can see the solution. So announcement welcomed by some small businesses, obviously, who have taken a loan of less than this limit, they would be happy. Retail loan takers who had opted for the moratorium, but also banks are also happy because government is going to pay the bill. After that, estimated that government is going to have a cost of around 5,000 to 7,000 crore, and there is one problem for banks that they would have to perform massive calculations or they would have to recalculate their estimates that they have done about the money that they would be getting back after the moratorium, right? So guys, these were the 5 questions for today. I hope you learned something new from this video, and if you did, then don't forget to give us a thumbs up, and I'll be back in the next session with some new information. Until then, you take care of yourself, keep your studies going on, and I'll see you in the next session. Thank you.